Hello, my name is Iakos, and I'm going to talk about a new library which parallelizes supermeshing of simplex meshes with non-matching domain decompositions. So this material is under a non-commercial CERA-like 4.0 international license, and the PDF will go shortly up on the web after the end of this session. So a brief overview of the talk. First, I'll discuss why we needed a new parallel library to handle supermeshing. A brief introduction of Fluidity, which is an open source CFD software. Then I'm going to discuss the new library, the implementations, and then present some results. So models which use multiple non-matching unstructured meshes generally need to solve a computational geometry problem. And in order to solve this geometry problem, they need to construct intersection meshes in a process which is known as supermeshing. We use meshes in order to define solution fields, and there are cases where two computational meshes must be used. These cases, for instance, are when the atmosphere interacts with a surface like the ocean model, like the ocean surface in an atmospheric ocean model, or for example, when we have meshes with different resolutions. In order to solve these problems, we need to use supermeshing, constructing some intersection meshes. And there is also so we have to cut this out. So let me remove this one. So I'm stressed. So the parallel supermeshing library is a library that handles domain decompositions when the two meshes do not match. So far, supermeshing has been handled in cases where the meshes have exact main domain decompositions. So Fluidity is an open source CFD code, which can handle one, two, or three dimensions. It features anisotropic mesh adaptivity, which means that the meshes get adapted during the course of the run of simulation. And this usually happens in order to increase the resolution of the intersection or interacting areas. It has several applications, and it's used for oceanic and reservoir modeling and mining and other uses. So supermeshing was originally developed to perform interpolation on two or more different unstructured meshes. And this is a very general technique which can handle a complex and unstructured meshes. Supermeshing allows equations to be solved on a complex unstructured mesh, while simultaneously uses input data from separate and multiple meshes. These meshes so far have to be, their domain composition has to be exact, and this is true for applications that use dynamic mesh adaptivity. However, it's not true for all problems. For instance, the immersed body method and fluid solid interactions, these two cases of problems cannot be solved with the existing algorithms. The main property of a supermesh is that each element of the supermesh is contained within exactly one element of its parent mesh. So for example, here we have two meshes, mesh A and mesh B, and mesh A is on the top left corner and mesh B is on the top right corner. the supermass of mass A, the supermass of mass A and B is on the bottom left corner, where we can see that we can see the original mass A with the same coloring, and in black and white we can see the new elements that have been created based on the input of mass B. And on the lower right corner we can see the inverse, where the donor mass is mass A, and we can we have a supermass which is created with mass B as the with this mass A as the donor mass. So the supermassing algorithm is quite simple and is trivially parallelizable. It is it has three steps. First of all, we identify pairs of elements, one on each mass which intersect, and we create a mass with their intersection, which is called the local supermass or the supermass. And then we transfer data from one mass to the from the two masses to the intersection mass. Applications like Fluidity, which use adaptive mesh, technologies, they can trivially run this algorithm because the domains of the meshes are exact. However, in the general cases, this is not true. And in order to make sure that to enforce that the domains match, we can create false mass elements or extend the masses, but this will usually lead to poor balancing or poor data distribution. So that's why that's why we have libsupermass, which is a new library with the following key capabilities. It's easy to use. It can handle unstructured meshes with non-matching domain decomposition, which was the main focus of the project. It's a general purpose library, which means that it doesn't know what kind of data the meshes hold. So it just performs data communication and supermeshing, and the calculations of this on the supermesh are left for the user. So the user has to provide the functionality to run on the supermesh. It implements several new algorithms for identifying candidate pairs of intersection elements, building on algorithms that already exist on Fluidity and some new ones. It has been tested to run up to 10,000 cores on Archer, and it has been tested with Fluidity. And actually, it is part of Fluidity code. So libsupermesh can be compiled on and run on Archer. It has been compiled and tested using GNU, the latest GNU Intel and Cray compilers, and it compiles and runs properly. It has been used with the GNU compiler and Fluidity, because Fluidity can only be compiled with GNU. You can get it from Bitbucket. It's very easy to install, and there is also a manual which is around 50 pages explaining how to use the library. And compiling with libsupermesh can be achieved by using a single use keyword. And the only caveat is that you have to compile libsupermesh with the same compiler and version, since this uses a Fortran module file, and the module file has to be the same version as your application. So the Fluidity already supports supermeshing, as we've said earlier, but only supports supermeshing on meshes that have an exact domain decomposition. So for the serial part of libsupermesh, we extracted the code from Fluidity. Part of the code was an interaction with Seagull, and we removed that because it was not needed. We also removed the Wild Magic intersection code. Wild Magic is an open source computer graphics engine which is used by Fluidity in order to do some element to element intersection, and we removed that because it was slow. We replaced all intersection code with optimized implementations, and we removed all dependencies with Fluidity data structures. Fluidity supports many use cases, and most of the data structures were too large and they contained too many things that, and most of them were not used by libsupermass. So we made the interfaces simpler, and we replaced all the extra functions, or actually removed them. So this improves performance by 1.7 times on the 2D and 3D cases. So we also developed or optimized several new algorithms. These algorithms are doing identification of candidate pairs of elements that may intersect. And all of these are based upon an axis-aligned bounded box, so it's an AAP being predicate. And we have the simplest one, which is the sorting intersection, which is mainly used for development and testing. And we have the quad tree intersection finder, which is based upon a quad tree data structure, and it's for 2D meshes. The oak tree, which is for 3D meshes. The arc tree, which is based on the Leap Spatial Index library. And also an advancing front intersection finder, which is described in CMAIM, the conservative interpolation between volume meshes by local galerking projections, by Dr. Farrell and Madison, which are the PIs of this project. And this advancing front intersection finder is already on Fluidity, and we ported it and optimized the code. The standalone library exposes several interfaces which can be used by the users to calculate a local mesh and a local super mesh on the intersection of two elements or two meshes. And these interfaces have been cleaned up from the Fluidity data structures. So they now accept simplices and they are far simpler to use. For the one dimensions or vector, we have interval intersection, and then for the two dimensions, we have an algorithm based on Sutherland and Hoffman clipping algorithm. For three dimensions, we have several interfaces which locate and intersections of convex polyhedra using at the plane at the time of clipping, and then we have general dimensions which are just convenience interfaces for users to use when they want to use the same code without using the dimensions of the meshes. So these interfaces will identify the dimension of the meshes and then call one of the three previous case of interfaces. The code has been integrated with Fluidity. And it is an optional Fluidity component that you can compile against, or and then it can be used as a replacement intersection and super meshing implementation. We wrote the regression testing suite. We also used the Fluidity regression testing suite because if you use libsupermesh as the intersector finder, then Fluidity will just use our code, so we could use Fluidity's test cases to verify correctness of our code, and we used these options to make sure that everything was working properly and we had no overflows or underflows. We also used bulk grinds to check for memory leaks, and so the results for the serial benchmarks of libsupermesh use two quasi-uniform resolution meshes. For the 2D cases, that are the ones that just so, which are two triangles with a different resolution. For the 3D case, we have a tetrahedron and the two identical tetrahedra with different resolutions. We have to use the same domain decomposition because this is the serial case which expects that the domain composition will be the same. The parallel implementation doesn't ignores the domain composition and can run on meshes that do not have the same decomposition. So the we can see that the R3 intersection finder for the largest case, which is 8 million elements, has a runtime which has been reduced from 141 seconds to 70 seconds. And this difference is mainly because we use a different version of Lisp Special Index. And we call it differently, and so it doesn't use the disk as a temporary storage area and just uses memory. For the advancing front, which is the one that we optimized, we can see that we improved the performance and we reduced runtime from 39 seconds to 14 seconds for the serial 2D intersection finder. For the serial 2D intersector, we reduced the runtime from 8.2 seconds to, sorry, from 13.5 seconds to 8.2 seconds for the 2D cases. And for the 3D cases, we also have some improvement. And so for instance, the advancing front is reduced from 116 seconds down to 16. And finally, for the 3D intersector, we can also see the improvement from 117 seconds to 67 seconds. And these measurements only measured the performance of the intersectors and the intersector finders. They didn't measure the time that we needed to create the fluidity data structures or clean them up. And if we measured the fluidity, the time that fluidity takes to build up the data structures and clean them up, then the comparison would be completely unfair because Lisp Supermesh doesn't use any of these expensive data structures. So as we mentioned earlier, and the algorithm for constructing a local supermesh is trivially parallelizable. However, this is the case as long as the decomposition of the two meshes are perfectly aligned. And in order to generalize this algorithm and to perform parallel supermesh calculations on meshes that are not perfectly aligned, we implemented the following algorithm. So I'm going to go through the four steps plus two sub-steps of this algorithm, and then I have an example later on. So the first step is to compute and then communicate the x-axis aligned bounding boxes of all meshes using MPI all-to-all. After this step, all MPI processes know the bounding box of all other processes for both mesh A and mesh B. For each mesh A, and by mesh A, I'm referring to the local mesh A, where each AABB box, its bounding box, intersects with the local mesh B, we have to identify the mesh B elements that need to be communicated, and then we send them to the process that intersects with. If there is a case where the local mesh A and local mesh B intersect, then we can calculate the intersection meshes immediately. And for all the other cases where the local mesh A does not intersect with the mesh B, we have to wait until the data from the other MPI processes are received, and then we can construct the intersection meshes and perform the calculations on the intersection meshes. therefore doing the supermeshing. So the first step is to calculate the AABB boxes of the local meshes and distribute them to all MPI processes using MPI all-to-all. And so, for example, if we have these two meshes, and we use any parallel partitioner, we can get this output, where the blue color represents MPI process 1, the green color represents MPI process 2, the pink 3, and the red 4, and the one on the left is mesh A, and the one on the right is mesh B. So we can see that the partitioner, the parallel partitioner, started with the top left corner, partitioned the mesh. It managed to partition parts of mesh A and B on the same processor, MPI process, but then it took a different path, so the mesh A gave the lower left part of the mesh of mesh A to MPI process 2, but gave the top right part of mesh B to the same process, same to process 2, to MPI process 2. And then it continued clockwise, and the final result is this one, which we cannot change. This is the way that the partitioner works, and this is the way it partitions the domains, the meshes. So as you can see, the domains are not the same. So we cannot use the trivial approach of doing supermesh. And now we can see the view, what MPI process 1 sees. So it sees parts of mesh A and mesh B. And overall, the MPI processes see these parts of the meshes. And you can also see the bounding boxes around each domain decomposition. So in step two, this is the view of all MPI processes after we communicated the bounding boxes across all MPI processes. So in step two, we have to run a test on each bounding box and see if the local mesh intersects. If it intersects, then that means that some or all, or in some cases none or no elements intersect, because if the bounding boxes intersect, this doesn't guarantee that the elements will intersect as well. So, however, if the bounding boxes intersect, then there is a chance that the elements will intersect. So each MPI process runs tests to check if the bounding boxes intersect. If they intersect with the remote one, then it posts an MPI receive, and it waits for one or more elements, or in some cases, zero elements. So for this example, MPI process 1 will be our local process. It has the local part of mesh A, and also it has the bounding boxes from the other MPI processes colored in the same color, in the appropriate color. So the green one is from the green, the pink is from the pink, and the red one is from the red. And it checks and it sees that it intersects with all three bounding boxes. So it posts three MPI receives and waits for the sends from the other processes. MPI process 2, 3, and 4 have the bounding box of MPI process 1, and they check that they intersect. We could at this point send all the elements of MPI process 2, 3, and 4 to MPI process 1, and let MPI process 1 figure out which elements intersect and which not. However, this will cause, we'll have to transmit and send lots of data. So these processes, in step 2A, these processes will do a local test and only send the elements that actually intersect. So MPI process 2, which is the green one, most of the elements that it knows about intersect with the bounding box. So the MPI process 2 will send almost all of the elements, whereas MPI process 3, only the top part of the mesh elements intersect, and the last process, MPI process 4, the red one, again it's one third of the elements could intersect. Of course, this doesn't guarantee that there will be an intersection, but we have to send these elements because they could intersect. So in this step, we know which elements of the local mesh B, and local mesh B is this one in this case, which element of the local mesh B, which elements need to be communicated. LibSuperMesh knows the elements and knows the number of elements and the type of elements that it wants to send. However, it doesn't know the user supplied data, because each element could hold one or more data points which will be used for the calculations in the supermeshing space. And since LibSuperMesh is a general purpose library, it can't know, it cannot know what type of data points or data entries each element and each vertex is holds. Therefore, the user is responsible for writing a function, which we call it a callback function, which will be called at this point in order to return to LibSuperMesh the an array of data, which will be sent to the other MPI processes and then unpacked at destination. The LibSuperMesh sets the number of elements and the number of mesh vertices, and then the user is responsible for writing the function, which will create the connectivity, the coordinates, supply it will return the size of the supply data and the actual data. So once we have the data and the data are in transit from one MPI process to the other, we can check if we have both parts of the local meshes and if we can do some part of the local super mesh. In this case, MPI process 1 has these parts from the local mesh, and we are in luck because this approximately part of the local mesh A can be super meshed with local mesh B. For the rest, we have to wait for communication with the other MPI processes. In the last step of the algorithm, we receive the MPI messages from the remote MPI processes. We have to use MPI probe because we don't know the size of the MPI message that we're going to receive. And the first element of the message is an MPI integer, which is the number of elements that we're going to receive. If the number of elements, if the first integer is zero, then that means that the message contains no elements, because it was one of these cases where the bounding boxes did intersect, but the elements, but no elements actually intersected. If the first integer is not zero, then it means that the message contains some elements, and we have to use a user-specified unpack function in order to unpack it. So that's the view from MPI process 1. After the communication, therefore, MPI process 1 now has enough elements to compute, to complete the super mesh. Most of the elements of the green process, which is process 2, send will be discarded, because even though the bounding box is intersected, no actual elements intersect apart from the ones at the bottom of the communication, and the top part of the red or fourth MPI process also intersect, and then we also have the pink one. So the final step is to do the actual compute the intersection meshes, and then run the user provided function which will calculate the super mesh. So in order to use libsubermesh in your application, the only thing that you have to do is compile libsubermesh, include the libsubermesh_parallel_supermesh module. Then you have to set up mesh data, and libsubermesh supports triangle or tetgen node and element formats. You have to create, you have to call supermesh, and in order to call supermesh, you have to have three functions, one to unpack, one to unpack, and one to perform calculations. And we have examples of these on the web, on the manual. And then libsubermesh will take over. It will compute the local supermesh. It will run the function that you have provided. And then at the end of the call, each MPI process will have the result of the local supermesh. If you want to do a null reduce, or if you want to have a global result, then you have to do it yourself. So, results for the parallel part of libsubermesh. We have 2D and 3D benchmarks. The 2D benchmarks use a triangle-shaped mesh and a square-shaped mesh, whereas the 3D benchmarks use a pyramid-shaped mesh and a cube-shaped mesh. All meshes were generated with GMC, and we use the FLDCOM tool from Fluidity to parallel partition the meshes. So the meshes look like this, and they have several hundred and millions elements each. And the left one is a 2D one, and the right one is a 3D one, where we have a pyramid and a cube, whereas a 2D is a triangle and a square. We run two types of benchmarks, a small benchmark and a large benchmark. The small benchmark has up to 33 million elements for mesh A and 29 million elements for mesh B, and the large ones go up to 300 million elements for mesh A and 264 million elements for mesh B. We didn't have time to try a 1 billion degrees of freedom simulation. So we have three types of benchmarks. The simplest one is just computation of the area for the 2D or volume for the 3D mesh. Then we have more complicated benchmark, which also does the L squared inner product of two piecewise linear continuous functions. And then an even more complicated function, which does the same but for a quadratic continuous function. So the first benchmark requires a couple of multiplications because it's just the area and the volume. The second one requires up to 150 multiplies and divides, and the last one is probably 100 times, it requires 100 times more compute than the second one. And so that's the result for a small mesh. Just computing the area, and goes up to 2,000 MPI processes. Because as we increase the number of processes, the number of elements that correspond to each process decreases. So for the 2,000 processes, we get an average of 17,000 elements per process, which is not high enough. So it's very low, which means that each MPI process doesn't have enough work to do. And since we know the geometry of the square and triangle, we can calculate the area, and the area has a value of 50, and we get results which are extremely close to 50, so we have a variance on the 11th decimal digit. there is a small spike, or if you check the, so the blue line is the runtime, which gets improved as we increase the number of processors, and the dotted green one is the ideal speed up, and the red one is the actual speed up. So as we reach 1,000 processors, you see a dip, which we assume, because we measured the library, we assume that's an overhead when we use more than one node on Archer. So usually the MPI all-to-all communications take 0.4 seconds. For instance, for the 2,000 MPI processes, takes 0.4 seconds, whereas when we use 1,000 MPI processes, it took 4 seconds, and this was reproducible. And all these results were run 5 times, and the first time was ignored, and then we have a mid, we take the average of the 4, over the next 4. So for the 2,000 MPI process run, the library spent 0.4 seconds communicating with all-to-all, and then 0.05 seconds sending and receiving data, because we send and receive point-to-point, and only with the MPI processes which intersect, where their bounding boxes intersect. And then 0.15 seconds computing for the local meshes, and 0.15 seconds computing for the remote meshes. And the parallel efficiency starts at 68% when we use 2 MPI processes, and drops to 27% when we use 2,000 processes. And so for the P1 L squared inner product, we see the same dip at 1,000 cores, and we see that the library scales almost ideally up to 400, and then there is this dip. So compared to the previous one, it scales a little bit better. The runtime also drops from, is reduced from 433 seconds to 1.5 seconds when we use 2,000 MPI processes. For the large meshes, we can also, for the 2D large ones, we can see that the runtime is again reduced, and that the speedup follows the linear curve very closely. There is a small dip when we reach the 8,000 and 10,000 core limit, but that can be attributed to the lack of elements. So when we reach 10,000 cores, we have 30,000 elements per MPI process, which is considered at the low level of elements per process. Usually you need 50,000 elements per process. Finally, the 3D volume calculation shows that, that was the 2D large one. For the 3D small one, which goes up to 2,000 processes, we can see that the runtime is also reduced, that the speedup follows the ideal speedup, but the parallel efficiency of this one starts at 68% and then drops to 22% when we use 2,000 MPI processes. For the 3D volume one, we have a better scaling, because we can see that the speedup follows the ideal speedup, and the runtime is reduced from 10,000 seconds to, which is 170 minutes to 7.8 seconds if we use 10,000 MPI processes. And the same for the P1 L2 L squared inner product. So as a summary, we improved the serial intersection finder algorithms, which are used by FluidDB, and We also integrated LibSuperMesh to Fluidity, so now Fluidity users can use the new intersection finder algorithms and intersectors. We implemented a parallel algorithm for supermeshing for non-matching domain decompositions, which means that the users can run supermeshing applications with meshes that do not match exactly. LibSuperMesh is available under an open source license, and we have shown that it can scale up to 10,000 cores for 100 million degrees of freedom for the 3D cases and 297 million degrees of freedom for the 2D cases. And we expect that that if we increase the size of the meshes, that this scalability will also continue. So thanks to the Fluidity project and to Arthur, and you can find LibSuperMesh at bitbucket.org/LibSuperMesh. So any questions?
So many thanks to Yefros. Thank you for coming along. Okay, so if there are no final questions, then we'll finish up. Okay, thanks very much.
Bye.